Hello, I'm Lyn Jarvis, contributing editor for Across the Fence, and today we'll explore Iceland. Why would you ever want to go there in the middle of winter, my skeptical friends asked? Well, because it's the best time of year to see the Northern Lights or the Aurora Borealis, one of Mother Nature's most spectacular phenomenons. And to do that, we'll travel to Hupt in the southeastern part of Iceland. Our adventure begins in Reykjavik. The capital city and a must for all visitors is to tour the Golden Triangle that begins at Þinglavir National Park. It's a beautiful sight with the sun rising over Iceland's largest lake, Þinglavir, with an area of some 32 square miles. Hard to believe, but this video was made at 10:30 in the morning, the time of sunrise here in the middle of winter. And with sunset around 4:30 p.m., we had to move fast to see all that this island country has to offer. Made Iceland's first national park in 1923, Þinglavir was designated a UNESCO World Heritage Site in 2004. Not just because of its grandeur, but the sulfur fissure is located here, a crack between continents formed by the constant pulling apart of two tectonic plates. Continents are embedded in tectonic plates and move at a rate of about an inch a year, and this is the only site above water that marks the meeting place of the North American and Eurasian plates. What a thrill it was to meander between two continents. Oh, I think I'll walk over to Europe today. Nearby is visual proof of all this underground thermal energy. The Strucker Geyser, surrounded by mud pools, hot water springs, and numerous vents for volcanic gas to escape. All this geothermal energy provides water that has to be cooled, not heated, before using. For fun, some people put eggs in this boiling water, and within minutes, they are hard-boiled and ready to serve. Strucker, which means churn, became active in 1789 after an earthquake. It continues to erupt every few minutes, shooting hot water some 100 feet into the air. Being so active, I was able to photograph the eruptions from several locations. I hope you enjoy watching them as much as I did. Our last stop will be Gullfoss, the Golden Waterfalls, located on the upper part of the River Krita. The rushing water cascades down two steps, one some 36 feet high and the other twice that, into a mile-long canyon. On this bright, sunny, cold day, this wonder of nature is an exhilarating experience. Upon leaving, one can't help feeling more at one with our Creator after seeing and feeling these unique wonders of nature. We had a day to explore Reykjavik, Iceland's capital city, before our flight to Hupt. Iceland is about the same size as Vermont and Maine, but our populations are 10 times that of theirs, just over 300,000 people on the entire island. Amazingly, but not surprisingly, some 800,000 visitors came to Iceland last year, making tourism their third most important revenue source. This is their Parliament House, a modest structure built in 1881 from blocks of gray basaltic rock. Members are in session year-round, except for a six-week summer break. Considered one of the world's oldest democracies, their government, called Althing, was established by the Vikings in 930. Next to the Parliament House is the Dumkiskan Church. It is the place where the Lutheran Church of Iceland officially endorsed independence. and members of Parliament since 1845 continue to gather here for a service before the annual session. Just behind, now nearly frozen over, is Chocton Pond, home to some 40 to 50 species of water birds. On this day, dozens of whooper swans had gathered to find shelter from the snow and cold. Birders from all over the world journey here to pursue their passion and can easily add many new sightings to their list. By now, the sun was setting on the old harbor. With its beautiful views and impact from the growing tourist economy, it is fast becoming a new and vibrant center for locals and tourists alike. When I saw the Harpa Concert Hall and Conference Center, it took my breath away. Opening of May of 2011, it was recipient of the World Architect Award. It is the new home of the Icelandic Symphony Orchestra and Opera. It has four concert halls, the largest seating some 1,800 patrons, and a large conference hall. International conferences and touring groups are welcome here. On the plane over, we traveled with high school students from Connecticut who were thrilled with the idea of performing at the Harpa. Another dynamic building is Oxkripka Kirche Church. Looking very impressive in the night sky, it is the tallest building in Reykjavik at 244 feet. The Lutheran church took 38 years to build and is said to resemble the basalt lava flows of Iceland's many volcanic eruptions. The statue in front is of Leif Erikson, the first European to discover America in the year 1000. It was a gift from the United States and was designed by Alexander Calder. Our time in Reykjavik will end with a walk along Laugavir Street. Very attractive after sunset, it is a popular place for locals and tourists alike to do some window shopping. A little after 9 a.m., looking like the middle of the night, we boarded Eagle Air for our one-hour flight to Hupt, giving us a beautiful view of Reykjavik as we headed off for more adventures. It was a smooth flight to Hupt, a small fishing port with some 1,800 people. It is one of the very few harbors in southern Iceland, with fishing and tourism being the main economic sources of income. And much to my surprise and delight, I just learned that lobsters are very plentiful here, and I plan to take advantage of that. But more importantly, there are 17 hours of darkness every day, so that should give us a pretty good chance of seeing the Aurora Borealis. It was a nice morning to explore this small village, and the harbor was our first stop. A beautiful sight with many colorful fishing boats. Skinny Tinganes is one of the largest fishing factories in the eastern part of Iceland and employs a large number of people, most of them being residents of Hupt, resulting in a very prosperous community with good schools, services, and medical facilities. This boat was just coming in to unload the catch of the day, which includes cod, blue whiting, herring, and lobster. When traveling, I always enjoy checking out the grocery stores. Since there is just one here in Hupt, it didn't take long. I have to say I was very impressed. In this remote little village, this store had just about everything one could possibly need, including my favorite stop, the bakery. The school is close by and it was recess. With stored up energy from those long winter nights and seeing a stranger with a camera, they went into overdrive. After that episode, the teacher apologized and took them to the skating rink for some serious playtime. With all that excitement, I was ready for dinner, and Harper brought me a delicious lobster pizza. Doesn't it look good? I wish I could share a slice with all of you. As the sun set, we glimpsed a spectacular view of Alpenglow and considered it a good omen for tomorrow's road trip. On our way at 9:30 a.m., the sun was just coming up. But take a look at the roads. Studded tires and sensible speeds are mandatory here. Glaciers in Iceland are as common as covered bridges in Vermont. If you look, you will find them. And no matter how many you see, each one is mesmerizing. We decided to stop at this one, and I'll let you figure out how to pronounce its name. But translated, it means Pig Mountain Glacier, as early settlers used to raise pigs nearby. It is one of about 30 tongues of the Vatnajökull Glacier, the largest in Iceland with an area of over 5,000 square miles. Its average thickness is 1,300 feet, and under all this ice are active volcanoes like Grímsvötn that last erupted in 2011, turning this blue ice into gray and canceled flights throughout Europe. It is amazing to walk along this great ice mass that at any moment with unpredictable force from volcanoes below can change the course of nature. It was a truly humbling experience. As much a part of Iceland as geysers and glaciers are Icelandic horses, and Marco Ayala, our video editor, and guide Sindri Bessason had a close encounter. There are more than 100,000 of them here, and they are often close to the road as they love attention. Vikings brought them here more than 1,000 years ago, and it is the purest breed of horse in the world. For centuries, they were the only means of transport carrying people, supplies and mail over mountains, rivers, lava fields, and even glaciers. They are famous for their strength, sure-footedness, stamina, endurance, and loyalty. Our last stop for the day would be another part of the Vatnajökull Glacier, the Jökulsárlón Lagoon, and it is breathtakingly beautiful. As the glacier slowly recedes, this 7-square-mile lagoon, over 800 feet deep, has been created. With the sun and clouds for a paintbrush, these icebergs in all shapes and sizes change colors before your eyes. Constantly moving, they slowly drift down a narrow river to the sea, where pounding waves push some of them back upon the volcanic sand, where they lay scattered like gems on black velvet sand. And keeping a lazy eye on all of this are many seals that just have to slide off the ice to catch all the fish they need to be fat and happy. Now, what you have all been waiting for, the Aurora Borealis, and to help with that, we got one of the best, Ronnie Huxon from Hupt. And I asked him how long he has been taking pictures.
I have been doing this for taking pictures for about 9 years. And it actually started when I was working as a captain at Jökulsárlón. I was sailing with tourists there, and most of the people were carrying fancy cameras, and so I decided, why not try this as a hobby? And I have been doing this ever since. Landscape photography, and I like it most, you know, to hunt the Northern Lights and take pictures of them.
What are some of your favorite photos?
This is a hard one. I have, I think, over 320,000 pictures in my computer. And there are many of them that I really love. But probably my favorite spot to take the Northern Lights pictures in, it's called Heinabergslón. It's a lagoon, small lagoon with floating icebergs. The nature around the lagoon is amazing.
For Across the Fence, I'm Lyn Jarvis on a windswept beach by the North Atlantic. Thank you for watching.